Hey guys, Cole Beeler talking about COVID transmission. Are you safe in the hospital? How do you protect yourself from COVID when it's everywhere? Am I a danger to my family when I go home? When do I need extra special precautions? All these are extremely valid questions in an era with a disease that can spread silently and rapidly, kill people more effectively than many respiratory viruses, and doesn't have great treatment options. So much is still unknown about this virus, but we have had a chance to accumulate some data by this point in time. Instead of regressing to the miasma theory of disease spread, let's talk about what we do know. COVID is a respiratory virus. It spreads from the respiratory tract of infected individuals. Even though we may detect virus in different organs, it does not effectively spread from the GI tract, tears, urine, bone, or other body fluids or tissues. I acknowledge that virus has been detected or receptors have been found in these tissues, but that does not mean the virus can adequately disseminate itself from these organs to get to the respiratory target tissue of the next host. Non-respiratory transmission would be atypical for respiratory viruses and even more atypical for coronaviruses. Transmission via inanimate surfaces is likely extremely rare. Even in the studies that have suggested it's possible, viable virus isn't commonly detected. RNA presence does not mean live virus. Transmission from mother in utero or in the birthing process is rare. Infection may happen after delivery, but the consequences of this, thankfully, are very, very low. Though they are still infectious, patients without symptoms don't transmit as well as those with symptoms. That said, 48 hours before you develop symptoms, you're likely quite contagious, and this pre-symptomatic group is difficult to sort out from those that remain asymptomatic for their entire course. Healthcare worker infections are common, but are multifactorial and may not solely be due to clinical exposures. The most common location for transmission of COVID is actually the home to people that you are living with. Older are more likely to get it than younger, spouses more likely than children. Speaking of children, they don't seem to be as able to transmit the disease as adults. I acknowledge that they probably have equal amounts of viral RNA in their oropharynx, but this does not mean that they're more infectious. Epidemiologic data cited here seems to imply that they are just not as effective vectors. But any rules we try and build around COVID are incomplete. There's literature in either direction, so how do we best protect each other with the resources that we have available? The first step is to understand that transmission of COVID is a function of time, distance, and density. The longer you're around someone with COVID, the closer you are to someone with COVID, the more COVID that's present in the space around you, the higher likelihood you will get COVID. Now, host factors may also come into play here, but this data is on shakier ground right now, so I'm going to leave it out, we'll learn more about this over time. We have settled on a rule of 6 feet for 15 minutes to define risk, but this is not an exact science. It's a great approximation, but if any single variable here is high enough, infection could occur. By understanding this, we can help protect our neighbors as we would ourselves. A general understanding of aerosols is probably also helpful. You may hear things get separated out based on size of infectious particle. Very small droplets hang out in the air long enough to have the water evaporate around them, leaving a small infectious particle that can travel long distances and potentially even through the meshwork of medical masks. Viruses that transmit this way are very infectious and have high attack rates. Measles is the prototypical example. Since they can spread throughout a building, we need to exhaust them outside so that they don't get to other people. But that description is probably overly simplistic. First, for every pulmonary infection, a mixture of aerosol sizes are likely created. We've detected everything from flu to rhinovirus suspended in the air in these particles. Sometimes these droplet nuclei can actually penetrate medical masks, the most commonly used masks for isolation in these patients. Infectivity of aerosols may increase over time if the air isn't released from its container. This is the density part of the equation. The next points are important. Just because we find a virus in a droplet nucleus or far away from a patient, it doesn't mean that droplet precautions are inadequate. Like I said before, we find most viruses in droplet nuclei, and the key is that droplet precautions are adequate to prevent infections with them. It may be that medical masks blunt enough of the aerosol to prevent infectivity. It may be that the virus doesn't transmit as well from that size of droplet. It may be that you don't get a high enough dose of the virus from anything but droplets, whatever. Regardless, it's important to note that aerosol distribution does not mean airborne precautions of all viruses. This decision should be made by epidemiologic data on the given virus, who is spreading it to whom, and what were they doing. So the main question, does COVID need N95s in negative airflow rooms in all cases? I would say sometimes, but not for routine care. Why? Well, for one, proximity is the key factor associated with transmission. That is typical for viruses that spread predominantly by a droplet route. Droplet nuclei don't have that proximity factor strongly associated. For instance, in a train outbreak with RSV, I would expect risk of infection to be higher the closer you are to the index infected patients. If you had a train outbreak with measles, that risk would be spread relatively equally among those in the same car. The former is more similar to COVID outbreaks that we've seen in air and train travel thus far. Second, masking, it doesn't matter what type, reduces the acquisition of COVID. This is not only argues for a primary respiratory route of infection, but also argues that even cloth masks are effective at blunting the infectious aerosols. So why all the excitement about N95s? Well, they are certainly a better filter. When compared under laboratory conditions, N95s were better at protecting the recipient and the source from transmission of the virus than surgical masks, which were themselves better than cloth masks. But I would argue, do we really need all that filtration power to decrease disease acquisition? In this meta-analysis of four randomized controlled trials, they found no difference between N95s and medical masks for the prevention of respiratory viral infection. The quality of the individual studies was relatively low, but it's probably as good as you're going to get for questions like these. The CDC acknowledges that the predominant mode of transmission is by droplets and is dictated by distance. They also acknowledge that there are certain situations where COVID may spread like a small droplet nucleus pathogen. There have been case reports, mind you, of transmissions that break out 6 feet and break our 15-minute rule. These have been in situations with poor ventilation and clustering, like restaurants, gyms, choir practices, etc. Because of this, the CDC recommends using N95s instead of medical masks when able. But does the ability of the virus to break the rules under optimal conditions dictate a standardized approach? I would say no. I'm going to describe a virus for you. It can remain in the air and infectious for 24 hours in droplet nuclei. It's been reported to infect people despite wearing medical masks. There have been clusters of multiple infections from one index case, and there are outbreaks cited with long-range high attack rates. Sounds a lot like COVID, right? But what virus could this be? Well, it's actually good old influenza. But that's weird. With all those super scary facts, why do we only use droplet precautions for flu? Familiarity is key here. The CDC has a standardized approach to all novel respiratory pathogens. The N95 is certainly a better filter under experimental conditions, and if there's any plausible suggestion a virus could be infectious in droplet nuclei over long or short distances, the recommendation is for N95s. I think this is a fair approach until we get data on the pathogen, but we are out of that window period for COVID and are learning more and more every day. They acknowledge that medical masks are an acceptable alternative if there are resource constraints. They do not cite evidence of risk with this scenario, just the lack of data. I would say that even with our current stockpiles, we have to be good stewards with our devices. We've already seen how behavior shifts can greatly diminish supply and projections at even one hospital. We never want to be in a position where we can't give an N95 to a person who is intubating a COVID patient. The implications of calling something an airborne pathogen that can spread by droplet nuclei and then not putting someone in a negative pressure room also seems inconsistent to me. Every time we leave a patient in their regular room but elect to wear N95s, are we sending the message that we don't care about the patient's neighbors who share the same ventilation or the nurses and healthcare workers in the hallway? These mechanisms of spread go hand in hand. If we aren't seeing spread in these areas, which we aren't, why do we also need N95s? The CDC also tends to approach any hint of evidence as the potential rule. COVID certainly has evidence of droplet nucleus spread. However, it is rare, as it is with all respiratory viruses. The problem with this generalization is that it sets the standard that if I don't have an N95, I'm less protected, more at risk, and need to escalate my concerns as a matter of safety. In actuality, this is a numbers game. Is there an elevated risk for you caring for a COVID patient with a surgical mask versus N95 when transmission through the former are extremely rare? Maybe, but it's negligible. And given the other constraints, to me, it doesn't seem worth the potential costs. You can see here that we're not alone. Many other national, international agencies and guidelines actually support using either medical masks or N95s. I completely acknowledge that others may come to different conclusions from the data available. That's okay. We have the supply. Team members should be encouraged to wear N95s in settings where they could be at elevated risk. But with the dearth of evidence and national international guidelines going either way, we certainly can't mandate N95s for the care of COVID patients. But when would we consider them? Remember, transmission is a function of time, distance, and infection density. It is the product of these variables. If any one gets too large, it may overpower the others and lead to infection. For instance, if I was taking an hour-long medical student history on a COVID patient in a small room, I'd consider wearing an N95 even though the patient wasn't in airborne precautions. I might consider wearing an N95 if I was going to be up close and personal with a COVID patient working to put on creams on their bed sores while they were coughing all over my face. Lastly, I'd throw on an N95 when doing an aerosol-generating procedure. This latter group's important. We define aerosol-generating procedures as procedures that create high velocity or fluid, of air or fluid, against the respiratory epithelium and have evidence in the literature for transmission of respiratory viruses. It's not enough just to create the aerosol. Those are made by almost everything. Farting is an aerosol-generating procedure. But is it conducive to transmitting the disease? Where's the evidence? Altogether, infection prevention can't do this math for you. You have to evaluate your own risk and make those decisions based on the care you're anticipating providing. I definitely don't think you need N95s for the majority of activities, but if I were doing an oropharyngeal exam on a patient who was coughing all over me for 10 minutes, I'd be a little more cautious as well. So do I feel like you're safe in the hospital? Yes. But only if you and all the other people around you are wearing medical masks. Studies have shown that universal masking with medical masks significantly reduces healthcare worker positivity. But it only works if you wear it. Speak up if you see someone breaking the rules. The corollary to that is to not take offense when someone tells you that your nares are hanging out. The most vulnerable time is when you're eating or drinking. This needs to be in isolation. Eating around other people has already been documented to result in transmissions. Remember that anyone could be infected. Don't work if you're sick, that's a duh. And lastly, wash your hands frequently. It literally helps with everything. So since surgical masks are so effective, how do we handle exposures in the hospital environment? Let me start out by saying that it is at least as common to get infected in the community where people are only wearing cloth masks as it is in the hospital, and likely more common depending on what you're doing outside of work. The CDC acknowledges that contact tracing is not worthwhile in the hospital setting when COVID is going crazy. It's impossible to tease out hospital exposures from community exposures, and the merit of quarantine in a setting with a limited workforce that is universally masking is very, very low. I acknowledge that our patients do not wear surgical masks while we are in their rooms, but we consider these situations safe for a provider, if they're wearing a mask, for all other respiratory viruses, and would not consider this a trigger for exposure workups. Certainly, if you feel you are going to be with the patient for an extended period of time or in very close approximation, it might make sense to have them wear a mask as well if they can tolerate it. We don't have criteria built up around this, but like so many things, you need to analyze your individual risk based on your activities and apply the appropriate PPE. Do you really need a policy to tell you to wear gloves during a rectal exam? The only situation where we would consider you exposed and at risk for spreading to your family would be if you were exposed to an aerosol-generating procedure of a COVID patient without an N95. In this situation, you can expect to hear from us and get guidance about how to handle your home life. I also want to reiterate that even if you are exposed, you can continue to work in the hospital until you develop symptoms. Viral loads peak on the day your symptoms develop. Even though you are infectious about 48 hours before this, the risk of you shedding to other people with a mask on is negligible. We operate under the assumption that all team members are shedding at all times. The bang for the buck of contact tracing just isn't there due to the protection that the masks provide and the fact that universal masking and symptom monitoring practices wouldn't change after the exposure. So in summary, these are my concluding points. I think that certainly there's a lot of concern about this, as there should be. But I think in most situations, we are protected with the universal medical masks that we are utilizing. Our knowledge of how this disease spreads should be based on the epidemiology. Certainly, if you're in a situation where you feel like you're at higher risk based on those factors that we talked about, time, distance, and density, you should feel free to utilize the personal protective equipment that you feel like would protect you the most, like with all infectious diseases. Thanks for your time, and don't hesitate to reach out if you have questions.